All right, well, good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of the Board of County Commissioners, my name is Doug Howard, Carroll County Commissioner for District 5, and I want to welcome you to Carroll County 2047. I want to acknowledge, and I'm not going to mention them by name because I will leave somebody out, but if you would wave your hand, we have some elected officials with us here today. We have some commissioners, some folks from Tawnytown, Westminster. All right, well, thank you all very much for being here. I want to just give you, they told me to be brief and not funny, so I'm really working hard at that, both parts. So, as you know, about a year ago, we formed the Long-Term Advisory Committee, and we asked a group of folks, leaders in our community, to take a look at where they are in their organizations, get together, talk together, but then also look at where things were headed, partly so that we could anticipate things, partly so that we could understand the challenges that we may face. And so it's really exciting because once you get beyond a few years, sometimes it's really kind of hard to do. And when this idea came up, we thought it was really an excellent idea. So first I want to thank the chairman of the LTAC, who's been instrumental in helping us organize all this, but also, and by all this I mean the committee itself, but also had the idea for this presentation today. So let's give a thank you to Bruce Holstein. Bruce, were you? We also have with us today a number of our LTAC members, many leaders in the community that are organized into various clusters like education and business, and we also have some citizen representatives. So if you are one of the LTAC members, could you just stand and we'll recognize you as well? We want to thank the Community College and President Dr. Ball for his hospitality and his use of the facility. Although, I don't know if we really ask as much as let you know we're on our way over, but we appreciate it anyhow very much. He's always very supportive of our efforts, and we're certainly proud to be here today at Carroll Community College, a great institution. So, by way of introduction, and I was asked to keep it brief, so I will, today we're going to hear from Jay Herson. Jay received his PhD in biostatistics from Johns Hopkins in 71. In 1983, he formed Applied Logic Associates, a research organization in Houston that provided data management, biostatistical, and regulatory services on clinical trials for the pharmaceutical and biotech industries. During the past 40 years, he's developed methods for design and analysis of clinical trials with planned interim analysis and sample size re-estimation. Jay now works as a consultant or data monitoring committee member for several pharmaceutical, biotech, and medical device firms. Jay's second career is that of a futurist. He has written articles on the future of the pharmaceutical industry, scenarios for the coming osteoporosis epidemic, the future of air travel, employment, primary care, global drug safety, and health insurance. He is the editor of the Future Active column in the World Future Society magazine, The Futurist, and a coordinator of the World's Future Society's Washington, D.C. chapter. Please give a warm welcome and your attention to Jay Herson.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner. Okay, can you hear me okay now? Yeah, it's okay? High enough? Okay, good. Thank you, Carroll County Government, and the LTAC, and Bruce and Chris, especially for all of their efforts to make this happen. I'm really delighted to be here. I'm told that this is being live streamed on Facebook. Would you believe there are 1,000 people watching this now on Facebook? Would you believe 200? How about three guys in a Turkish bath? Oh, this will be a good audience. Okay, here we go. So there's the title. What I'm going to be talking about today is comes under the title, usually, of strategic foresight. And this is an analysis of trends. What direction are we going? and how to plan for a desirable future, which I think you all want to do, and changing course when necessary, and it is always will be necessary. It is certainly not a prediction, and it is not regional planning, which is something that Bruce and I straightened out when I started this. And you have worked with regional planners before, and they're a vital part to your work. But if I were to say today the biggest disruption in real estate in the next 30 years will be because of changes in the nature of employment, changes in the delivery of healthcare, and demographic changes, and I will say something like that today, then if you believe that, you might then go to a regional planner who will say, okay, well, if that's going to happen, we have to have rezoning, we need some new roads, maybe the community college needs both a north and a south campus, that kind of thing. I would not want to do their job. I think mine is easier. Here is, in graphical forms, inputs. Things are happening all around us. And then foresight has three levels. What seems to be happening, what is really happening, what is behind what we see, what are the drivers, what might happen, and then the outputs. What might we need to do if these things are going to happen? And then strategy, what will we do and how will we do it? And all of us in this room have a part in all of these levels. Now, I wanted to talk about futurism in the pop culture first. I like the Back to the Future movie because it was a 30-year prediction. Only they went backwards, so it was easy to do. It starts in 1985, they go back to 1955. They knew both ends, and they obviously there were no surprises. But then when they made the sequel, it was 1985 going to 2015, so it was possible to, again, see this 30-year prediction. It was also late October when the movie, both the original and the sequel take place. So it's appropriate, I think, to start that with this talk. And they were correct when, obviously, we all know what happened in 2015. We even know what happened in 2017 now. But they did predict that the Chicago Cubs would be in the World Series, and they were only off by 1 year. Skype, they predicted Skype, and we saw that. They had flying cars. Most of the pop culture is always wrong in what's going to be flying for some reason. But flying cars and a hoverboard, he had a skateboard in the original movie, and he had a hoverboard in 2015, which was not the case. And power shoelaces never came to being, although we all wanted them, but they never came to be, at least not yet. Now, the Blade Runner movie was made in 1982, and they were predicting 2019. And this movie is more serious. It's about the singularity. And there were robots, apparently, that were manufactured long before 2019. And the robots are called replicants because they were able to reproduce themselves. And we can't tell the difference between a human and a replicant. But the latest model of the replicants have gone rogue, and Harrison Ford has to come out and find them and shoot them. And I'll say more about the singularity later. But in this movie, they also have flying cars for 2019 and other types of things like that. But in the movie, the household furniture, computers, and office furniture is all as it existed in 1982, even though it's supposed to be 2019. And those scenes are very dim, so no one will notice it, because they didn't want to go there. They wanted instead to show flying cars. Now, there is a sequel, came out just a few weeks ago, Blade Runner 2049. And this only 2 years off of what I'm going to talk about today. But here they've gone haywire with flying cars, just everything unbelievable. Both humans and the replicants can dematerialize and materialize again. I don't have that as a prediction for 2047, maybe by 2049, but probably not. Also, if you've been watching, all of the Blade Runners take place in Los Angeles. If you've been watching the World Series, you know it's over 90 degrees in Los Angeles now. So this takes place in November of 2049, and it's snowing. And it's a peculiar twist on the global warming, I guess, and it's supposed to surprise people. But now, here. This is, an Englishman made this, predicting 2017 to 2050. What is brilliant about it is this is the exact London Underground map that many of you have tried to figure out when you were there. And what they call trend lines here are the colors of the actual lines of the London Underground. Now you've got all of these stations with different names. The major stations where there are interchanges have major trends, but every station has an issue that will come up as a prediction for the year 2050. And it all makes sense. I'll just give one example. There's an anxiety station is up there somewhere. And this occurs is a station that has three lines that cross. Technology, media, and politics are the three trends that create anxiety. And all of these others make sense too. It's an amazing work, and they even have game changers down there. When you're mowing your lawn on a July afternoon, do you ever think, I wonder what other people are doing now? This is what other people are doing while you're mowing your lawn. Anyway, I have a copy of this, suitable for framing, in Bruce's car right now. He doesn't know it. I dropped it there before. And maybe this will help you with your work or confuse you more even than I'm about to confuse you. In 1950s sci-fi books, there is a father, a mother of opposite sex, married, long-term, first and only marriage, two bio children, and the father goes to work in a rocket, and the mother stays home all the time and makes dinner in a pill. Maybe some of these things will happen by 2050, but there are a lot of things, obviously, that have happened even by the 1970s and 80s that they wouldn't have predicted. That's because it's easier and it's more interesting to predict technologic change than social change. And so they didn't even go there. Everyone assumed social life will be the same, and they couldn't have possibly ever thought that there'd be a sign like this in a bathroom in 2017. So again, I'm going to say more about this. David Sarnoff was, it seemed like forever, the chairman of the board of RCA, which owned NBC, now part of GE. And in 1946, he appeared in a newsreel, the newsreel series Time Marches On. It was shown in the movie theaters mostly to publicize Time magazine. And out of nowhere, he's standing next to the original model TV set, and he says, this month we're starting to sell these in department stores and appliance stores. But someday, this is what came out of the blue, someday people will carry television sets around in their pockets. And nobody knew where this came from. And can you imagine, the director of engineering goes back to his staff after hearing this and says, gentlemen, and it always was gentlemen in those days, I've got good news and bad news. The good news is we're getting the day after Thanksgiving off. The bad news is we have to invent the internet. So, but what David Sarnoff couldn't have possibly known in 1946 is Moore's Law. And that was coined in 1965 by Gordon Moore, who was one of the founders of Intel. And he said that now that we have chips and transistors, the number of transistors that can fit on a chip will double every 10 years. So here on log paper, and we look back and we see it should be a straight line on log paper, and it is. And that has happened, and that is why your smartphone is possible today. Some of you may remember the 8086 or 286 chips, or 386, always waiting for the new model to come out. And if you go up to the top there, you'll see chips that are in your smartphones. Now, this car is not for sale. It is a 1987 Toyota Camry. Question is, does everything change? If one of these was parked out in the parking lot and I gave you the keys, you'd feel a little strange in it, sitting in it and getting used to the arrangement of things, but you could probably drive it home if you have a driver's license. And similarly, if you lived in Rockville, Maryland, and you worked at the Treasury Department in DC today, we could send you back to 1987. You would get on the same metro stop and get and the same commute and get off at the same station you would today. And you could even be in the same exact train car because they're still in use. You may be watching the 2017 World Series, but if I gave you free tickets and sent you back to the 1987 World Series, between the Minnesota Twins and the St. Louis Cardinals, you could follow the game. There'd be certain things that are different, but you could follow the game and root for your favorite team. So in doing futurist work, we have to also concentrate on what won't change, and I'll mention some of those things today. So I'm going to talk about trends and what are the drivers of trends, that is what causes the trends. What opportunities there are for the county? I think that's why you all came here. I'm definitely going to talk about that. Wild cards, things that we don't expect to happen. They might. They would have a high impact. But I'm going to show you how futurists classify these and plan for them. Then four scenarios for the year 2047, and we'll vote on them. And then we're going to take a walk along Center Street on Saturday, October 26, 2047, and I'll describe what I think you might see. Now, I'm going to talk about trends in each of these areas. I'm also going to talk about the clusters, and I'm not going to go in a particular order, but by the end of my talk, I will have covered each of these areas and your favorite area is probably up there somewhere. But there are mega trends I want to also emphasize, and we might call these the drivers. The irrelevance of the federal government, changes in the nature of employment, climate change, urbanization, demographic change, surveillance and big data, and automation. And these are not in any particular order. It was the order I thought of them, but I will cover them today. Now, the federal government, in 2047, all government is local. I think the commissioners will probably agree that's even that way today. But the federal government that we have, all three branches have failed to perform as the founding fathers had planned. And you read about it all the time. The state boundaries are outdated. They came about by land grants to white male landowners in the early 18th or late 17th century, and we still have to live with them today and have our representatives and senators coming from them. A lot of this in 1790, compromises between the landowners in the big states and the small states. Shut up, Delaware, you're getting two senators. So this kind of thing went on, and we live with essentially the same constitution today. Some states, like California and Texas, have threatened secession, and the five counties in western Maryland have threatened secession. This won't happen by 2047, but again, people are frustrated that what is happening in Baltimore and the DC suburbs is not the way they live their life in Western Maryland. But how local must we get for people to accept compromise? And how will we ever learn to compromise? In a condo building in Camden, the Camden neighborhood of Baltimore, what's good for people who live on the second and third floor is not good for the people who live on the seventh and eighth floor. And we can't even get compromise in a single building. I'm going to talk about that too. Now, there'll always be federal block grants. Social services, reproductive and general health, local transportation will be up to the state. There'll be corporate local partnerships. I know we already have them in roads, bridges, and transportation. And there'll be some privatization of roads and bridges. Now, people have talked about, this is short run, but people have talked about, can there be light rail service between the Hunt Valley and Westminster? I think that could come about. I'll tell you later why this will be irrelevant by 2047. This could come about if Hunt Valley and Gettysburg would get together and take the lead. I mean, if they could justify a light rail between the Hunt Valley and Gettysburg, surely there'd be a stop in Westminster. But this is bringing another state into it also, which makes it more complicated. But the tracks that are laid, if they did this, they would be needed for the autonomous vehicles that I'm going to talk about many times in this talk. So local government, there'll be a lot of pressure on state and local government. And the idea of citizen legislators could return. The founding fathers in the federal government, they never intended for people to be in Congress for 40 years and make it their permanent career and do whatever they can to be elected or else they've lost their job. The idea is someone, I don't know if it was a different world back then, but someone would say, yeah, I can leave my farm and go back and forth to Washington for two years, and after that, someone else can take over. I can do that. Well, we don't have that, but at the local level, we have the chance for that kind of turnover, new ideas, people in the job because they want to do the job, but not because they want to do whatever it takes to make a permanent career. There will be autonomous vehicles on the roads, and this puts pressure on local government. There's going to have to be a lot of road changes, and this is why I think there'll have to be some privatization. I'll mention later what the changes will be. But there can also be interstate and inter-county collaboration. If another county has figured out how to do something, Carroll County wouldn't have to reinvent the wheel. Even another state, Delaware, Wyoming, they already have this with healthcare or transportation or whatever it is. It could be copied. And similarly, ideas from Carroll County could be copied somewhere else. We don't have a whole lot of that going on now, but I think in the future we will. Now, I'm going to now, I want to define several terms that are going to be used throughout. And so I want to explain what they are first. Blockchain is a computer technology. It is a personal ledger. It's beginning now. Secure and trusted transactions. Bitcoins, you've heard of bitcoins as a currency, all computerized. That the blockchain is the technology behind bitcoins and their competitors. Important contracts will be on blockchain. Food tracking, drug tracking, drugs of all kind tracking, health and education records will all be on blockchain. I'm going to bring this up a lot of times. But now I mentioned the community college could teach or prepare to teach a course in blockchain management. I'm going to be coming back to the community college continuously in this talk because I'm going to be mentioning jobs of the 21st century that the community college can be training people for now. It is easier to train someone who lives in Carroll County, who wants to live and remain in Carroll County for a 21st century job than to recruit people outside of the county to move here and do those jobs. We have to do that also. You will. It can't only be this. But the way to start is what is easiest. So this is the first. I'm going to continue to come back to the community college. I'm going to talk about the gig economy. Instead of full-time employment with benefits, people will work on gigs, short-term contract employment. I'm going to explain how this will happen, why it isn't such a terrible thing, but again, this is the definition. Learning and co-working centers, I'm going to talk about this as well. It is a facility where students and adults come together to learn, possibly K-12, at the learning center, or to do their work, or to be trained for a new career. It can be in a school building, converted factory space, converted retail space, and it can be commercially owned. Later, I'll tell you what outside of Carroll County, what is going on with co-working. So let me start with education and learning. Education is K-12 and post-secondary. Learning is a lifetime task. It doesn't have to be in a schoolroom. Riding a bicycle and learning new occupational skills come on up in learning. I'll talk about both. First, K-12. I'm going to talk first about progressive school systems, the way they will be in 2047. Somewhere in this country, there will be school systems that are not progressive. I'm going to talk about them too. But first, teaching by computer lessons. So there will be computerized lessons, somehow standardized, that the students will have their computers, and there'll be outstanding teachers, like a TED Talks kind of thing, that the students will learn. They can ask questions and get answers. And there'll be teaching by non-teachers. What I mean by that is, supposing the class has to learn about the Iowa caucus. What the heck is the Iowa caucus? The governor of Iowa could record a lesson, and whatever school systems around the country subscribe to this service, their students will learn from the governor himself. Now, that may be better than a teacher the night before saying, I have to teach the Iowa caucus. Every 4 years this damn thing comes up. What the heck is it? Where can I look this up? Where can I learn this? There will be coaches in the learning centers, people with different types of certification who will help the students with their lessons at the computer. There will be a stress of group rather than individual achievement, which is going to be necessary. We have to work in groups. The three C's will replace the three R's: critical thinking, collaboration, and compromise. All be very important. The end of rote memorization. When I was in the fourth grade, the teacher might have called on me and said, Jay, what is the capital of Kansas? Well, either I memorized it or I didn't. Either I can recall it when I'm surprised by being called all of a sudden by the teacher and pointed at, or I can't because I'm too nervous. And besides, the value of this information for a nine-year-old growing up in Queens is questionable. But people will learn the capital of all the states, but in collaborative, in groups, and the student records will be in blockchain, so if a family moves from Baltimore to Denver, all of the records come with them and in a standard format. Community college, education, coach, training. Training a curriculum for education coaches, because I believe that's going to be an important job by 2047. By the way, what is the capital of Kansas?
Topeka.
Very good. So you memorized it, though, didn't you? Okay, anyway, learning centers. Learning centers, where the students go, K-12, can be in existing schools, unused factory or retail space, and there will still be homeschooling. Several children in a neighborhood, perhaps go to someone's house, and if that were certified for homeschooling, they can have the computers and do that, something similar there. The libraries can be learning centers, and the co-working centers, which I will say more about, all of these can be of different sizes and have the space and the facilities for as a learning center. The community college can give space for learning centers, and courses in learning center management, I would think, would be important. So learning centers are K-12, but also adults learning new skills, especially under the gig economy. The gig ended, I want to get another gig, but I may have to have some new skills because the job of my last gig has been replaced by robots or something. There will be occupational training at the learning centers, and it may be on a commercial basis. However, payment only for results, so that we cannot do training the way we do today. So somebody might pay, in $2017, let's say, $50 to register for a certain occupational course at a learning center. Now, if they get a job and they stay in it for 6 months, they can get a percentage of the earnings, 2% of the earnings, or maybe local government will pay them $10,000. You did it. You did what you were supposed to. If this doesn't happen, they don't get paid anymore. So they'd have to think carefully about having the best technology for teaching people and not teach courses like we are today, a 60-year-old welder to be trained to be a webmaster, and the training center gets paid whether the person gets the job or doesn't. That will have to end. We can have guest coaches coming in on videos and other ways from science and law in the teaching, learning records in blockchain, and a co-working center or a library can also be a learning center. And the learning centers will include daycare, I'm sure. Now, private schools, they will take hold in less progressive school system. I mean, that's where most of them will be, where the parents who are in those school systems, they want to have a more progressive kind of teaching. Now, but this will go corporate by 2047, I'll explain why, and national, like Marriott, Hilton, and McDonald's are national companies. Now, don't go home and tell anyone that I said that Marriott and Hilton are going to be in the private school business. I don't mean that. What I do mean is that anything that can be standardized and lends itself to regional control can be rolled out nationally. And that's why these three companies have a national presence. And that would be the most efficient way to do it. Some charter schools and learning centers could be somehow incorporated with private schools, or at least in the same building. Many real estate opportunities here as the need to convert factory space, retail space, that is not being productive into the, this type of facility. Now, post-secondary, young people are not going to be driving up to the fraternity house in the Mustang convertible in 2047. Some, but not as many as in the 1930s or in the 1950s. Because the post-millennials, and I'm going to talk about them a lot at the end of this talk, they're concerned about that, and they're going into college right now. And they were born in around 2000. And they are concerned about the cost of a four-year college and student debt. Their parents haven't still, maybe their grandparents still haven't paid off their student debt. They don't want to get into that. And what I tell you is, I read this from surveys that the Pew Trust do and others. It's not just my own idea. And what they're questioning the value of the education anyway. The gig economy is not consistent with a four-year college. So I go to a four-year college, I still have to go from gig to gig. and I don't ever know what's coming next. There'll be a tremendous growth in community colleges because they're going to be teaching the practical courses that I am now pointing out in this talk, but they can think of much more than I can think of, I'm sure. A la carte education. Take courses for a particular skill that's in demand at the time. IT, robotics would be the case today. So take the course, maybe at a learning center, and then, okay, fine, maybe they continue or else go back to the learning center for something else. There'll be training in learning centers, and of course, there's always on-the-job training. Now, post-secondary, females are interested in the broader education and the social opportunities in a four-year college. So I think in 2047, we're going to still have this, the colleges, and I think there's going to be even more female than today. Asian students prefer the four-year college and grad school, but mostly in the STEM technical professions, and nothing wrong with that. And those students will of both genders will be in the four-year college and the grad school. 50% of post-secondary education in a traditional college by 2047. Not more than that like we have today. Now, employment, I've said a few things about. Average rate of unemployment by 2050 in 10-year increments. This is using the definition of employment that we use today. Full-time, permanent, lifetime, benefits. We know that is disappearing. Now, in 2020, you have 11%, and we've read, and it is correct, 4.2% unemployment today. However, we have these older people who are retiring. Even as I speak, there'd be thousands of older people handing in their retirement notices. And we don't have as many younger people to fill those jobs, but some of those jobs are irrelevant anyway, and we haven't trained people for the jobs, not enough of them, of the jobs that exist today for some of the reasons I've just given. So that's where the 11% is coming from. The gig economy will be 60 to 70% of employment and by 2047. People employed on contract. We talk today of the Hollywood model because in Hollywood, when they make a movie, I'm going to say more about that industry later, but when they make a movie, people are coming together, probably never to come together in this form again. But better than that, the Hollywood model is, I need a group of people. Let me give you an example. A person in Baltimore is opening a restaurant, and then through the internet, they may get the theme for this restaurant. Someone in Paris has got a gig for that. The interior design, someone from Seoul, Korea. The menus maybe will be designed by someone in Norfolk, Virginia. And these people will come together in web-type Skype meetings, and maybe even permanently. But the advantage of the model B, and I've been in the pharma industry, I've been in Hollywood model committees, the advantage of this is these people can concentrate on the work. They're not bringing the baggage with them of having worked with the guy sitting next to them for 30 years, and why did he get promoted ahead of me, and I don't like him for this reason, and why did they ever hire this young person? What are they teaching in college these days? None of that comes out. People can concentrate because the group is coming together for this purpose and will never come together in this form again. Now, people will be matched up at the internet or whatever they call it then, a global basis. They can work from home or in a co-working center. I'll tell you why people might choose the latter. And the co-working center, I'll get back to this, but it can be a library or a former factory space, as I've said before. Now, you know, they used to say the one disadvantage of being an atheist is you don't get the holidays. So one disadvantage of being a gig worker is you don't get a retirement party. Although there are a lot of people that work for the federal government that would be very happy if there were no more retirement parties. But But a friend of ours lives in San Antonio, but starting in 1990, she worked on short-term contracts in IT, and even part of that time for General Motors in Detroit, where she went up to Detroit a few days a week and a few days from her home. And she did this with insurance companies, a lot of different companies, for 25 years. When she retired, she said, I have to create my own retirement party. I don't have an employer to do it. So she did, and a lot of friends came over, and a lot of people came by Skype to wish her good luck. And there may be more of that happening. I don't think the community college has to teach retirement party planning. We have people who know that. But everyone who went to that retirement party wanted to be there. They didn't get summoned from the eighth floor, come down to the cafeteria, it's time for this guy's retirement party. Now, temporary placement firms can be very helpful here. They will still exist. A person can register with a temp firm like they do today, and they can go over the internet and match up if people don't want to do it themselves. And maybe they will have specialized websites that are proprietary, databases, I mean, that only they can use. And that will be helpful. And also, there is a company in Boston now called BioBridges. And there's a huge biomedical community industry in the Boston area. And people go to them for gigs. I mean, I have a friend, whenever she wants to work again, I mean, she's in her 60s, but every once in a while she wants to work again, she goes to BioBridges. They have no trouble getting her a gig. And it is also possible, if there's a really hot profession like IT or pharmacology, a temp placement firm might say, okay, I'm going to give you 3 years employment with our firm and benefits. Yes, benefits. Because I know I can keep you placed throughout the year. And if there's a few valleys where you're not placed, okay, so what? I'll eat that. I'll still come out ahead. And I think for the really hot professions, that will happen. Gig employment management, I think, will be something that the temp placement firms would need, would be another, and also for teaching people how to interact with to get gigs. Men are disappearing from the workforce. They're not being educated for the professions or for STEM as before. And autonomous vehicles will reduce a major employment option for men. The biggest employment of men worldwide is driving, and in the United States as well. Now, there will be creative employment. Some people want to be self-employed because the heck with this gig stuff. And Etsy is a company today, handmade items sold via the internet that people make in their homes or with others. Lush is a company today, a handmade soap, a very fancy soap, sold via the internet and even in retail stores that are called Lush stores. And people at home follow a recipe and send in their product. The co-working centers will be a place for handicraft workers to work and share ideas. And the community college, creative arts, that is, how do you make soap? But more important, creative business management. How much should I charge for this? Where do I get the customers? Which website should I use? This will be something someone may want to drop in and take even a two-week course on at night on something like that. Now, the co-working centers are closely related to the learning center. People who would prefer to work among others rather than at home. Today, we have all kinds of people working from home for employers that are far away. But some people would like to work among others. The co-working center has resources, hardware, software, and daycare, even yoga and Pilates and a food court. Now, or of course, Starbucks. Some of these will be in the high-end co-working centers, but there'll be all kinds. Unused factory space and outdated arenas are being converted to co-working centers today. And they will be privately owned, although there's no reason an Economic Development Commission could not at least start a co-working center to get the ball rolling. And here, this is the U-Line Center in Washington, D.C. It's located in a gritty neighborhood close to Union Station. It was called the Washington Coliseum. My wife went to the circus in this building with her family in the 1950s. Its other claim to fame was in 1964, after the Beatles appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show, they had a concert at the Washington Coliseum. It has been vacant for decades until someone fixed it up like this, and you can see all of those upper floors are for co-working. The REI, you know they are the outdoor company, REI has retail in the first floor, of course, because there's young people all working upstairs. The first floor can have a food court, a yoga, Pilates, Starbucks, and U-Line. Why the heck is U-Line? Who are they anyway? They are an office supply company, and they may be starting this in other cities too, but they will have a retail store on the first floor to sell office supplies to the people co-working upstairs. And I just read, just one more thing about co-working, a company called WeWorks has just bought this week the Lord & Taylor flagship headquarters department store on Fifth Avenue in Manhattan for $850 million. WeWorks is in this building. They could pay $850 million because of their market cap. The market cap is there, not because Joe in Scranton decided to take a course in something or other at one of their centers. The market cap is there because the market believes co-working is a big thing. And they're going to have their corporate offices, some co-working, but their corporate offices in that beautiful World War I era building that had the beautiful displays at Christmas all the time. One more Christmas with them. Universal Basic Income, the UBI. The universal basic income is eventually, and Scandinavia is already on to this, and they're always the first to think of these things. The let's say everybody will get $10,000 a year, even Bill Gates will get $10,000 a year, and this will help them save while they are working on a gig, and tide them over with their savings as well as this payment while they're between gigs. And it'd be both federal and state contributions to the UBI. People will gain training in different types of jobs. There'll be automated training for new skills, as I've said, at all of these places. And people can live in Carroll County even today, regardless of where the employer is located, and that will certainly continue. Automation, 50% of jobs in 2017 will not exist in 2047. This is what the experts say, and I can believe it. There will be autonomous vehicles at your door. The autonomous vehicles, they'll be in all sizes and shape, depending on the length of the trip and the purpose of the trip. But they will not be individually owned. People will go just like they go Uber today, and an autonomous vehicle will arrive at their door and take them to wherever they want to go. The Postal Service will be automated in kiosks, in Walmart, Safeway, even the lobby of a Hilton hotel. You know, when you go to the post office today, the clerk has the computer thing and is doing, and then you can see all of the choices come out. There's no reason in 2047 or even sooner that the customer cannot do that in a Walmart store. But Walmart may have some of their employees trained and certified to do work that has to be done in person. But the limestone post offices are going to disappear. This is something else that can be reworked. Now, delivery of mail and packages by all carriers through autonomous vehicles. Delivery to a community drone port or directly to each residence. Just this week, Amazon is starting Amazon Key, where it will allow their driver, will have a code, and because the homeowner will set the code, the driver will enter the code, the door will open, and he or she can put the package in, and all of this will be videoed so someone at work knows who it is that just entered their home. Now, this is a precursor, for sure, to having a robot come in and do that. I'm sure that's why Amazon is doing that today. The fast food, automated ordering and delivery. But many foods will be manufactured on site through 3D printing. Now, this sounds awful, probably because it is. But ask any old-timer, they will tell you a hamburger at a restaurant in 1937 isn't the same as a hamburger today in 2017. But we have to choose among what there is today. And the standards we have are based on what exists today. And they will get better at this. They've already done this, but not yet ready to be given to a customer, but they will get better at that, maybe more protein, and could be. And distribution centers will be manufacturing centers through 3D printing, and we have in Carroll County distribution centers. They may be actually doing the manufacturing by 2017. Or you can go to your local library and see a 3D printing demonstration, but what it does is it prints in layers that are so small, can't possibly see the difference between the layers. Now, Random House, I know, is in the county. They may be doing print on demand today, and if they are, that is something like 3D printing. And the shopping centers may still exist, and they may help with the 3D printing of clothing. Obviously, people will be able to do 3D printing of their own clothing in their homes, but the shopping centers might have the ingredients imported from Spain to make belts and other things like that are not available on the internet, certain patterns that are not available on the internet. So people will go to the shopping center and they will probably print their own clothing there. The 3D printing of houses is already working on this, and that can make housing more affordable. But the universal basic income is going to be a factor in affordable housing, which I know is an issue that you are talking about. Universal basic income is only $10,000, well then the developers will know, well then we can only build houses like this, higher density, yes, but not single family anymore or for a while, but then lobbying to get that increase, then maybe other kinds of housing. I know the LTAC is looking at all kinds of factors about affordable housing. In 2047, their successors will be looking at the level of universal basic income. And affordable housing can also come about through co-housing. Co-housing already exists today. A developer builds houses, and they're fairly modest but affordable, meets a right demographic. And the people who sign up have communal responsibilities. There is a communal dining room, gardening, other things. Everybody who lives in the development, in the co-housing, has a job that they do. And then it's maybe a little like a 55-plus community, but they save money because the people are doing this themselves, and the housing has been seen to be, many retirees are going to co-housing today because it's more affordable than other options for them. Now, 3D printing has many opportunities. Community college, training in 3D printing management and marketing, libraries as service centers, rather than just a 3D demonstration today, they can be a service center where certain products, you go to the library and have it manufactured. The library can also be doing on-demand printing of a book if people still want to receive a book on paper. Now, there's also 4D manufacturing. 4D printing. That's the manufactured object changes its size and shape over time. If you think of a cardiac stent, that doesn't have to be explanted and a new one put in if they can get this technology down. It will change with different cues from its environment in the arteries, and also maybe closer to home, orthodontic braces. If they can change as the child is growing, that would save a lot of money. And they're working on that today. The supermarket, order online, delivery by an autonomous vehicle, in person. Some people want, I want to see the exact fruit that I'm getting. I want to see the exact meat that I'm getting. If people really feel like that in 2047, they can go point and click, and there'll be an automated delivery a few hours later, but of the exact one that they clicked on, not another one, because that's the one they chose. That's for the fussy people, if fussy people still exist in 2047. But just, in my neighborhood, I don't know what you have here, but in my neighborhood in Bethesda, I go in and I get a clicker, a mobile device. Not everybody does it. It's only crazy people like me. They go, and then as I shop, I click the barcode as I walk around. And now when I go out, I just put that barcode under a reader, and it already gives me the bill, and then I put in a credit card. I shop in a huge supermarket without interacting with a single human being. This is all going to be more of that in the future. And when they started this at the supermarket, there were like three aisles of this automated check it, I think they call it, and the rest were human checkout. Now there's much more a big area. It's like, you know, voting election day, where they have the electronic machines in a square. That's what they have for checkout now at my store, and much fewer checkout, traditional checkout. But when the damn thing breaks, or you can't figure it out, you need the humans. But I didn't need one at least yesterday. Now, agriculture is important. I want to spend a lot of time on that. The inside of a tractor will look like the cockpit of a Boeing jet. In 2047, it probably does already. Automated chemistry for every square inch of soil. Information is coming from satellites and databases all over as to what should be placed by the tractor in that square inch, which may not be the same as 2 or 3 meters away from that. The dean of the University of Maryland Ag School will be an IT person who never worked in a field. Now, the concerns of GMO will be the same. Corporate farming, again, there's going to be more of that. There will be reduced employment due to automation, but we'll still have family farms. And agri-terrorism will be a bigger threat in 2047 than it is today. Now, what are the opportunities for the county? The University of Maryland might want to do ag, robotics, IT research in College Park, artificial intelligence, and IT. Well, there could be a field station in Carroll County, perhaps as a joint venture with Caterpillar and John Deere. If you have that, then startup companies, small companies working on this kind of automation can come and build centers. And in fact, the University of Maryland might say, we don't want to do any of this research in College Park. We want to build a building for you to do all of this in Carroll County. And that would be, I think, would be good. And think of the kinds of people that would move into the county. All people that move into the county are good people, of course. But people who can afford the housing, children in the schools, educated, if that's what is desirable, this kind of thing can create that. The community college can get involved with training for agricultural robotics and anti-agri-terrorism. Now in Pittsburgh, in the 1960s, steel was the main industry of Pittsburgh. Lots of pollution. They were just beginning to figure out that steel plants are not good for the environment. And then Carnegie Mellon University decided, well, we hire this professor to give one course in artificial intelligence. And then there were two courses and three courses and majors and grad school. And today, there are many artificial intelligence companies all over Pittsburgh, and there are as many, if not more, autonomous vehicles on the streets of Pittsburgh today than there are in Silicon Valley. And one would have to drive around a long time, perhaps in an autonomous vehicle, to even find a steel plant. And things like that, here we're not replacing agriculture in what I'm talking about. We are enhancing it and building on the strengths. Now, synthetic biology. Engineered transgenic seeds to produce desirable characteristics in crops, reducing the need for pesticides. Crops can then produce biofuels, chemicals, and lubricants. People are working on that today. Again, similar opportunities with the University of Maryland and industry for a synthetic bio-ag industry. Now, other opportunities. Autonomous buses can be scheduled for Baltimore to go to the symphony, art museums, to go to the Hippodrome. The demand will be known by big data. We won't be dependent on someone or the county or someone else doing a survey. How many people really would want to go on a Sunday afternoon to Baltimore? Maybe we need a bus. With all the surveillance we have, and especially with the registrations in the autonomous vehicles, they will know for every day, every month, every time of day, who is going where. They'll even know their names, and that's the unfortunate part of it. But still, once they see, oh my God, we've got to get a bus to go to Baltimore. And it will be an effortless trip to do that. So, and the same as I was talking before, Hunt Valley to Gettysburg, the demand will be known eventually. And you will get your line from Hunt Valley to Westminster. The lots of IT people will be needed in Carroll County in coming years. This can bring the people, as I say, to the county. Automation management training would be a very important for the community college to get into. And I know when I finish, someone from the community college is going to come up to me and say, we're already teaching that, and that's wonderful. Now, other opportunities, state of the art, IT, robotics, and artificial intelligence people are being moved from a company's remote location to the corporate office. McDonald's had a beautiful office park in the suburbs of Chicago, with a man-made lakes and all kinds of stuff like that. But that's where the IT people don't want to work there. They want to work in the city, and to attract them, the corporate office is being moved to near their CTA, their mass transit in the city. Caterpillar in Peoria, they are moving to Deerfield, Illinois, a suburb of Chicago. The same reason, they can't attract the IT people that they need in Peoria. And Marriott is currently in an ugly office building in an ugly office park in North Bethesda. And now there is a sign up, they're going to move to an equally ugly modern building in downtown Bethesda, downtown, where it's already overcrowded, where they already have too many apartment buildings, but the IT people want to be able to go to restaurants and walk to work and all of that stuff. Now, what does this have to do with Carroll County? Well, even the first does, but Marriott didn't move here. But there are back office computer programmers. These are the traditional programmers, the people that work on payroll, human resources, purchase orders, important work. They are Under Armour, T. Rowe Price, and Marriott will all need all the space they can get for these IT people because their businesses are IT now. Not before, but now and in the future, their businesses are artificial intelligence and IT. So where will they work? Well, then perhaps the county could say, well, we can accommodate the back office programmers in converted factory space or new space or something. I think there are very good opportunities here. Jersey City was not a very attractive place to live at one time, but the Wall Street firms are bringing all kinds of IT people and automation people that they need to be in Wall Street. So the back office people are working in these beautiful modern office buildings in Jersey City now. You can see them if you ever go the Hudson. You can see them. They're very pretty, and now it's more expensive to live in Jersey City. So again, these are ideas. Artificial intelligence. As AI systems become capable of learning themselves, they could replace many knowledge workers. Robotic systems may be able and likely able to repair and modify themselves. This is what the Blade Runner is worried about. And after 2030, the definition of unemployment will have to change, because who is it that is doing the work anyway? Singularity, as I mentioned briefly at the beginning, is the robotic awareness of self. The line between humans and robots becomes thinner. Already, we have designed cars are our feet, calculators are our minds, GPS is our sense of place, Google is our memory. Why can't all this be built into a robot? And they wouldn't need us to go online to do any of these things. A problem in the late 21st century, not 2047, I don't think, despite what that movie says. Entertainment, I know you've talked about that. It's expensive to go to entertainment venues, and because there's a rich and poor gap, what can we do about that? There is already and will continually be less demand for public entertainment spaces. They're not safe. You see what happens in Las Vegas and Manchester. We read about this all the time. But mobile devices have, as David Sarnoff predicted, the mobile devices have the entertainment. And people like to be at home and not come out in groups. It's also easier to attract advertisers to the mobile device. And I'll explain in a minute, your cell phone will have advertising that is just for you, because they know what you've been shopping for recently. The guy watching the same World Series game or the same television program on his or her mobile device will be getting a different ad. So in the short run, they have a live streaming of performances in local public spaces like the Metropolitan Opera and the National Theater. And perhaps, I think some of this is being done already, and that would be good. But a lot of communities like Bethesda, outdoor movies in the summertime in a big field, the admission is free. But then there's all kinds of stands set up in the periphery selling food. And in the summertime, like every Friday night, a different movie. And we have it in D.C. and Bethesda, and a lot of Baltimore has it also. Now, if this to be, people have told me we need to build an arena. Well, as I said, by 2047, people are not going to want to go to arenas, maybe even next year. But if they wanted that, there'd have to be sponsorship of a Carroll County company that does a lot of business here, and there, if that can be done, that's what it would take, they would require zoning changes to have that kind of thing. Now, entertainment in 2047, someone said when I came here in June, be sure to say this, fewer movies will be made with actors because they're a pain in the neck. They come, they have this, they get all kinds of problems, they have prima donnas and their harassment suits, all of this stuff. And computer animated movies. By animation, I don't mean Bugs Bunny and Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck that you grew up with. They have now three-dimensional looking and all computer controlled, very human looking, and that's gonna be better by 2047. And the studios will create their own actors, actresses, and they will use them in other movies, and they will age over time. But there'll also be news of all the problems that these people are getting into. They're getting married, they're getting divorced, they're drunk and driving. And it'll glue people who are interested in this without having to depend on humans to do this kind of thing. I have wandered in cities and I have seen they're filming a movie. Oh, this is interesting. And there's a big tent of all kinds of people, and then the stand-ins come and go. They walk into the building, and then they do it again, they do it again. Then the real actor goes in and does it twice, 20 takes of that scene. Then I always go and see the movie. That's 12 seconds in the actual movie. This has to be very expensive. And then they worry the first week at the box office they didn't get enough money. So there will be animated singers as well as actors, computer-generated songs, and this can be a global competition. Why can't, with this technology, why can't a studio in Croatia make a movie about people who live in Fort Wayne, Indiana? This global competition will mean maybe lower prices, but more creativity, more for the consumer to choose from. Virtual reality, I won't say a lot about it, you know, wear this over the head, and 360 degrees, so you may be seeing a scene from a movie, but as you turn around, you see what, if you were there, what you would see if you turned around. I saw a demonstration of that in Quebec City last summer. They will still be able to stream entertainment from the human era to a device. So if you want to see a Meryl Streep or a Leonardo DiCaprio movie in 2047, you'll still be able to do that. The Internet of Things. Virtually everything is connected to the Internet and can communicate with one another. The items in the home can be addressed in different locations and through Alexa. You've seen the Alexa device can answer any question. That's there just as a precursor. Eventually, it's going to be connecting you and turning off lights and turning off the oven, or reminding you the oven is overheating and stuff like that. Community college, digital home appliance management will be a challenging area. Now, there's going to be surveillance everywhere by drones, and for security, which is important, but also to aim advertising. Mobile devices at the gas pump, you've probably, there won't be gas pumps in 2047, I know, but today, when you go to a gas pump, you see gas station TV at some of them. Well, coming soon, you put in your credit card, they know that you shopped for a mortgage in the last 30 days. So you will get an ad for a mortgage company. Or if you've just come from, they know you just came from Burger King because your credit card, they will have an ad that says, this is why McDonald's is better than Burger King. So all of this comes from from all of the electronics we have overhead anyway. In the airplane, the same thing. There'll be advertising just directed at you before you choose the movie you want. And in the hotel room TV. Now, the airports, I think everyone will like this. Walk-through screening, not take off shoes or anything, nothing out of the suitcase. Walk through, they will know, two doors. One door opens into the corridor of the departure corridor. If the other door opens, just a further screening. We have a precursor of that even at the airports today, but it's more invasive. No more toll booths, of course. We won't need them because of the autonomous vehicles, but they will be paying their way. But while we have cars, transponders on cars record the entries, automated Bitcoin payment, or I suppose credit card payment. The community college surveillance management would be a very important thing to be teaching. Now, healthcare. Johns Hopkins, I have an association with Johns Hopkins, but that's not why I'm bringing it up. They are, all, of course, they're all over Baltimore. They're all over Montgomery, Prince George's County. They own Sibley Hospital in DC, and they have primary care also in DC. And they own Suburban Hospital in Bethesda. They own hospitals even in Florida now. Now, maybe that's not so exciting, but the doctors at Johns Hopkins in primary care, They're all on salary. They are not physicians have gone from business owners in the 20th century to shift workers in the 21st century. And they don't get any money or kickbacks because they referred someone to a cardiologist or an ophthalmologist. They earn the same salary whether they do or don't. But moreover, the specialists of Johns Hopkins, like the ophthalmologist and the cardiologist, they say, okay, if the patient has this, do this for them, do this for them. Don't send them to us until you have all of this. And of course, they have all of the records coming to them because the primary care person did what they were supposed to do. This will be done in 2047. And also, the pharmacy won't look exactly like this. I know they have the Minute Clinic now where they non-urgent care and the flu shots that you're probably all getting now. But there will be primary care physicians, nurse practitioners, and physician assistants at these, not every pharmacy, but at a lot of them. And they'll have, of course, the records will be on blockchain, but even before that, someone from Baltimore moves to Denver. They were a CVS patient in Baltimore, they become a CVS patient in Denver, and all of the records are there. The big chains, like Walgreens and CVS, are managing employee health services today, and they will do that more. So if I'm a CVS, or if I take a new job in a new city and CVS is running the employee health service there, I may very well want to become a patient at a CVS clinic because all the records would be transferred. Now, dentistry is becoming scalable. We still have, in 2017, the individual practitioners. But dental grads don't want or can't buy a practice. They're too much in debt, or they don't want that kind of a life. They want to work for somebody like the doctors are doing. And they are creating now a dental therapist occupation. They already have the dental hygienist, but the dental therapist is a person who can fill cavities under the supervision of a dentist who'll be on site. This creates a lot of efficiency, and because that, companies are buying up individual practices with the idea of merging them and having a building where you've got the general dentist, the oral surgeons, and the endodontist. If you have teeth like me, you know all of these terms. But they in one place. And again, this is because dentistry can be standardized, and it lends itself to regional supervision, so it can be rolled out. Tremendous real estate opportunities, I think, medicine and dentistry, creating clinics of this type, but working with big organizations to do it. Insurance will be all up to Maryland at that time. Statewide single-payer health care for those who want it. They might call it Maryland Care for All. There'll be supplements via private insurance like we have today. Health records on blockchain mean people can take their records from provider to provider. This creates competition, too, between our providers, which we don't have today. How many people have said, yeah, I should change my doctor, but this guy's got all my records going way back 30 years. I should stay with him. That won't be the case with blockchain. Health technology, yes, robotics. There will be wearable technologies, wearable clothing that will change in different heat and hot and cold for your comfort, but also send you messages and send perhaps your doctor messages about different things that they notice, your blood pressure and other things like that. Surveillance of the home, in the home, through the Internet of Things, the urine chemistry will constantly be done, and they probably will be able to see a lot of things in your blood just by your walking around, no more drawing blood. There'll be nanoparticles in drugs which give a lot of good properties to those drugs, but also can send a message to your physician that you did in fact take the drug or that you haven't taken it in 2 weeks, and the physician can intervene in that. precision medicine, one size doesn't fit all, and you've read about this, but they're making good strides in cancer now, where I do a lot of my work, but all of the medical areas, there will be more precision medicine. Not everybody with the same diagnosis gets the same treatment, but tailored for their needs. Neuroscience, big field for research, today and forever in the future for medical use, Alzheimer's, of course, and other dementias we have to deal with, but also for marketing. The more we know about the brain, the more we can get people to buy things they don't want, they don't need, and they can't afford. And that is a step above the way advertising is done today. Health technology, there will be drug-resistant pathogens that we will have to deal with. This is a possible wild card. And CRISPR is gene editing, which means they can go into the fetus, not do an abortion, but they have enough knowledge to edit. If the patient, if this fetus has Tay-Sachs disease, Down syndrome, they can edit the genes. Not yet, but they feel they'll be able to do that. And they have some progress with dogs or mice now. This can also, there's always the unintended consequences. So this could also be used to create designer children. So everybody's children will be like Wobegon children, the smartest and the best looking. And all the children will look the same. Now that can be outlawed, and probably will be in a lot of states. Can't rely on the federal government, but in a lot of states, but there's no reason people can't go to clinics in other countries for this type of designer children editing, and that could be a problem. The community college, no, I'm not going to get them into this editing, but wearable technology and management, very important area. Health behavior. Drug addiction, well, they're going to be more potent drugs. The drugs that are being used for addiction today, people will laugh at them in 2047. There'll be newer ones. There's lots of money to be made today, and there will be a lot of money to be made in the future. But I'll tell you, when I get to law enforcement, I'll tell you some more about this. Obesity, not much change, but health education programs at the Co-Learning Center, education the way for people who are obese, pay for results, pay $50 to register, and then so much for the weight that was lost after 6 months, otherwise only $50. That way, more effective programs will come out. We have an aging population today, and we still will in 2047. The gig economy does not yield retirement incomes, but the universal basic income will replace Social Security. And while they're in the working years, people get universal basic income. Hopefully they're also working. And then that continues into their retirement years. The same thing and maybe there'll be more money for the seniors. State programs for assisted living and nursing homes will still exist, but lots of robotics in those places. And the village movement, village, it's an uppercase V here, but with a lowercase V, in Montgomery County, we have 20 villages alone, what the village is, neighbors helping neighbors age in place. So a group of neighbors get together, and they come up, they train volunteers. They can do things for people who can't leave their home to pick up a prescription. With certain insurance, they can drive people to their doctor appointments. They can come in and change a light bulb, other things like that. Teach a senior how to use a smartphone that they just got as a birthday present. All of this is being done at villages today, and the idea is it delays a person from having to move out of the community they live in and move to another state where their children are, or move into an assisted living. It doesn't delay it forever, but it can delay it for some time. Health providers, more women as physicians and in leadership, all levels of healthcare, more Asian American and Indian American, in all health provider categories by 2047, The health aids that we have today, and they're very valuable, they're going to be more American due to the gig economy and due to the uncertainty of immigration laws that more Americans may be taking these jobs. But if the immigration laws allow this, my mother had these wonderful aides in Queens from Guyana and Jamaica. Jamaica, BWI, not Jamaica, Queens. And they were wonderful, and I hope that can continue. Healthcare opportunities, I mean, the community college can be training people at all types of healthcare jobs. It probably are already. Real estate, facilities, and housing for all of the people that will come, hopefully, to work in healthcare. Demographic, it can bring younger families to Carroll. And employment, because many healthcare jobs defy automation today and will even in 2047. Traditional employment in 2047, that means full-time employment with benefits. In all of the areas I've mentioned for the community college, but just to touch on a few, automation, support, management, and sales, agriculture, healthcare, learning and co-working centers, real estate, tourism in museums and parks will still be popular. And with the gig economy, people have a lot of time to go to the museum and the park, probably. Also construction, roads, the redesign of factory space, and housing. Gas stations will have to be converted to electric fueling stations. Police and fire department, they'll still be the force, but they'll be IT-oriented people working there, a lot of them working in the central precinct, keeping track of information they're getting in an automated way. Some reduced employment levels due to automation. They won't be chasing people with speeding tickets anymore because it's going to, with the automated vehicles, I think there will be less of that. But there will be the need for the autonomous vehicles. The autonomous vehicles today, they read stop signs and they read traffic signals, but that's going to end. The stop signs and the traffic signals will be there for pedestrians, but electronic signals are going to have to come because that's better, easier, and speed limits on the highway will all come electronically to these vehicles. They won't be reading signs. Lots of redesign of the roadside furniture to accommodate that. That is going to employ people. And this is why I said there may be some privatization, corporate and government partnerships in making this transition. Climate change, global warming. There'll be rising sea levels in Baltimore and Annapolis. Well, Carroll County doesn't care about that, probably, but except residents and businesses close to the water will have to move. They don't have to move as far as Carroll County, but Carroll County can be making a pitch. Look, if you're moving anyway, these are all of the good reasons to live and work and have your business in Carroll County. I would be going to those coastal communities. Norfolk, Virginia, already, when the tide is in, already has roads that are not passable. The agriculture, perhaps you can grow, we can grow crops not possible before in 2047, but what crops will be lost or reduced in value? If there's warming, a warming climate, manufacturing is expected to be more expensive, whoever is doing, whether it's robots or humans. Public safety. Drone surveillance and blockchain transactions should reduce certain kinds of crime. Real-time video coverage of a break-in sent to the homeowner and the police. We have that today, but if someone enters the home and a person is at work or at a co-working center, they will get a beam on their smartphone. Look who's in your house. The homeowner and the police can say, get the hell out of there, or whatever. But by the facial recognition that we have at that time, the police will already know who it is. Even if they've come from Wyoming to Carroll County to break into a house, they will already know who that person is. Faster identification and arrests. RFID tracking of children and pets, that is an implant that can be made. We do that today, but again, through the cellular network, child is missing. My friend's cat was missing. He went hysterical, didn't have RFID, but the cat showed up, when it got hungry. But it's easy to track people in autonomous vehicles, and police want to do that. Fewer accidents, I think the police will be happy with that. But there can be a criminal use of drones and robots for sure. Fewer volunteer firefighters at risk due to robotics that will be used, not necessarily fewer volunteers, but they won't be put at risk as much. Drug trade. Bitcoin payments can probably be tracked with a warrant, but cash will still be used for some transactions like these. Okay, so somebody does a drug deal with cash, fine, but now they go into a Walmart store, they want to pay in cash instead of bitcoins. Well, this is a suspicion, isn't it? Where the heck does a person in 2047 get cash from except by doing a drug trade? Guns, surveillance can give warning. For example, a person carrying a weapon near a school entrance, on the street, anywhere, there can be a warning to the school, a lockdown, because they know that person is carrying metal. There was a big thing after the Connecticut shooting, awful, December a few years ago, that in the elementary school, well, we have to build metal detectors in every school. Well, that's impractical. We know that. But the surveillance can help us with that by 2047. Everyone wants to know about state and local taxes. Changes in employment can reduce the tax base. I think the commissioners have already been thinking of that. The new technologies will be expensive and have short half-lives, so they've got to be, that changes employment and also reinvestment by businesses. But how do we tax employers of gig workers located in another state or country? That's a problem today as well. Well, what we are going to do is we're going to tax automation in all forms. Every robot doing work in every factory will be taxed. They have to be licensed and taxed. Every autonomous vehicle will be taxed, just like you do a car registration today. And that, they hope, will supply the revenue that is needed. Now, social and demographic changes, I've left that for the end because I said it's the hardest to predict. We want to know who are the people making decisions in Carroll County in 2047. Where do they come from? How do they think? In local government and state government, who will be the commissioners? But who will be the voters who put the commissioners in? How do they think? What do they want? I'm going to cover that, believe it or not. But I believe that social change can be tracked by what is politically correct from era to era. So let me start with that. In 1957, we said Miss and Mrs. By 2017, Ms. Because it's nobody's business if this person is married or not, and all lifestyles are as good as any other today. But politically correct in 2017. He had one child from his first marriage, one child from a relationship, no children from his current marriage. In 2047, the same person will be described. He had one child from his first relationship, one child from his second relationship, no children from his current relationship. The distinction between marriage and relationships are not important and nobody's business. Of course, there'll still be marriage, but the distinction will be not important anymore. It will be politically correct to use the word partner to replace husband, wife, or spouse. The co-parenting is starting now, not in Carroll County, I know, so let me explain what it is. Two individuals decide to raise a child from birth. There is no romantic relationship. They don't live together, hopefully nearby. They may be same-sex or transgender. The child usually comes from adoption in these cases, but there can be a bio child or an IVF, but usually from adoption because of how fast this decision is made. But what if The co-parents then go on and marry other people. They actually have marriages. They have children with the people they are now married to. They have other co-parenting relationships, several co-parenting relationships. One parent then moves to another city. Well, okay, if this goes on, who are the grandparents of these children? The siblings, the aunts, uncles, and cousins. What is the effect on the development of this child, of their performance in school, if this takes off, and it might not? But we will see virtual families. Families defined as a bond between close friends, not necessarily related. People who live or once lived in the same community, who worked or once worked in the same office, bonding together and acting as a 20th century family, getting together for holidays and giving all kinds of support. Well, just when we think we've figured this out, can a marriage consist of more than two people? Could these three people get married in one ceremony? Well, Justice Kennedy, in his wisdom, when he wrote the same-sex marriage decision, he said nothing in this decision could be construed as meaning that a marriage can consist of more than two people, because he's already thinking. The people who complain, they always want to complain that there should be something different than it is today. So as soon as there's same-sex marriage, people are going to come out and say, well, by that decision, there can be a marriage of three people, good-looking people like these three. Now, the people in power making decisions in 2047 are the post-millennials. Their parents are the millennials. Urban, 47 to 57 years old in 2047, raised in a world less centered in America than was for their parents. At least they'll be digital natives. They know everything about technology. They've been raised, perhaps, with helicopter parents. Single parent, step-parent household, two or three adult relationships themselves by the time they reach this age, college debt, perhaps. Their post-secondary education will vary in a way that I have described before, and they are known to be risk-averse by what we know about them already. Periods of unemployment and underemployment due to the gig economy might not have much of a sense of humor because of that. They use technology to communicate, but not for news. Now, we've always defined generations by this generation got their news from newspapers, this one from television, this one from the internet. These are post-millennials are not getting news from anywhere. But they use a technology to communicate with one another. And by news, I mean news that would be in a newspaper. They're getting all kinds of news from their friends. And they are distrustful of democracy. Look what happens when you have an election. And they've been exposed to fake news more so than people of our age group. So they will, as a result, they're suspicious of everything they hear. They're not concerned with privacy and surveillance. They grew up with it, and they've seen benefits. A non-linear, less predictable life story. The DNA origin of these people will be less Europe, more Latin America and Asia. The interest in public services and the universal basic income and health care, they will be for that. But they will be preoccupied with their own and their family's insecurities while they are trying to work in government or while they're going to the voting booth. Less concerned about people owning homes. I know we've talked here, you're doing a lot of talk about affordable housing, but the post-millennials may not want to own homes. They might prefer to be in high-density rental housing because their parents may have lost their homes or came close to losing their homes in the last downturn, and they know there'll be more downturns. Now, in Bethesda, I talked before, you've seen this and you've seen other places, all kinds of new high-rise apartments all over Bethesda. They're all for leasing. They're not condominiums anymore because it's the young people, same in DC, the young people who are moving in, they want to, I'll worry about a house some other time. So if someone goes to a commissioner in 2047 and says, what about affordable housing? Some commissioner might say, what the heck do they have to own a house for anyway? They can rent an apartment. So, and the post-secondary education narrower than the tremendous education all of you were able to get. Government more by trial and error and intuition, not all that bad. Reliance on expert panels. Let's bring in the experts on healthcare. Possibly from all over the state or all over the Northeast. Experts on transportation, experts on various things. Let's see what they say we should be doing. And also other governments. So if another county, another state had a way of doing something already, they could borrow from that. Women will be foreign-born, non-Maryland-born, hyphenated Americans, invisible government positions. I mean, women will be, as well as people of both genders, that are foreign-born, non-Maryland-born, invisible government positions. Lots of support for technology. What are the leadership requirements of 2047? We need people who can lead the state and local residents into the changes in employment, deal with climate change, think globally, take advantage of the opportunities that 2047 will bring, adapt, especially for zoning changes, the preservation of agriculture and agricultural research, and so you have to think, will the people that are growing up in the next 30 years be able to give that kind of leadership, or what kind of leadership will it be? High impact wildcards. I think the LTAC should do an exercise like this, and let me explain. What is a wildcard? What did I do? This one, okay. Agri-terrorism, a surge in co-parenting. Okay, you can read these. I'm gonna come back to it if I know how to press these buttons. There's type 1 through 4, probability. What the probability means is experts have said there's a high probability that this will occur, but credibility is, does the public believe it? And the public and do the politicians believe it? So we always have this bifurcation, but let's go back now and look, not that far back, go back forward. Okay, agri-terrorism is probably a 1. Experts say it's low, and there's a high credibility that the experts are right. That is low. For now, a surge in co-parenting, I explained, I think there'd be agreement, the low probability, and we agree with the experts on that. Severe weather, if it's a 2, that means the experts say there's a high probability. Credibility low. We don't live near the ocean. It's low, but it could go. You see, you have to watch. When is it progressing where this becomes disputed in the community? And when do we get to the point where there's a high credibility in the community? We want to intervene before it gets to a level 4. The definitions of forward and backward have changed. That's why I get it. Global pandemic virus is probably a 3 now. High probability, say the experts at the Centers for Disease Control, but in the community, it's disputed. The North Korea bombs the US is probably a 3 now. Russian interference with the election is probably a high by some experts, but disputed in the community. And systemic financial collapse is an example I think is high today. But what you have better examples and things that are maybe more closer to home, although everything is close to home in the future and even today. But you need to go through this exercise, have people come up, especially in their own clusters. What are the wild cards? And go through this classification and watch for changes over the next 30 years. Okay, we're going to go to 4 scenarios for the year 2047. I call them stormy weather, cloudy with occasional light rain, periods of sunshine, and sunny and clear. Okay, cool. Stormy weather, 2047. The community college does not update the curriculum, The learning centers are not progressive. Affordable housing was not achieved. Rezoning attempts fail. The gig economy causes more unemployment than expected. The UBI exists, but it's not sufficient. Agricultural robotics research is done elsewhere, and manufacturing follows the IT talent. Wait a minute, it gets better. Occasional light rain. There is some rezoning, some high-tech manufacturing, still not ag robotics research. Co-working centers host some gig workers and adult learning, but some fail, go out of business. Limited affordable housing, not conveniently located. Consumer college adds only a surveillance repair course. Shame on you. And the UBI is of some help, but not enough. Periods of sunshine. Rezoning is beginning to take hold, yielding affordable housing, more co-working centers. Community college expands their curriculum. The UBI requirements are at least better understood. The University of Maryland agrees to do some ag robotics research in the county. More active gig workers than were predicted before. Rezoning also permits more co-working and adult learning centers. Sunny and clear. The community college becomes a four-year college. Rezoning is welcome. Affordable housing and health clinics now conform. Ag robotics research attracts private industry. Distribution centers become high-tech manufacturing centers. A younger population, enthusiastic and successful gig workers are now living here, and the UBI is helping people of all ages. Do you want to vote on these? I'd like to see what the commissioners vote for, but the how many vote for number one, stormy weather? Okay. Occasional light rain? Remember, this is what, not necessarily what you want, but what you think might happen. Periods of sunshine? Okay. Okay. And sunny and clear? No. Yeah, good, good. She'll make it happen too. Okay, now, we voted. Good. Now it's Saturday, October 26, 2047. You're walking along Center Street. The Carroll County Times has an article about what some crazy futurist predicted 30 years ago today. And it is a Saturday. At least that prediction is right. There'll be surveillance everywhere. Many people know you are walking there, who you are, and that you are walking on that street. Drones buzzing overhead. I don't think this will be wrong like it is for the sci-fi movies. All your clothing are made in the USA by robotics or even 3D printing in your home. Autonomous cars on the road. Some hybrid cars will still exist on farmland. Most commercial buildings of today will still be standing, but repurposed possibly. It'll be a predominantly rural county with municipalities of higher density. Today's unincorporated areas will be incorporated by 2047, and some new fledgling municipalities will appear. Commute to work in Baltimore, Frederick, Rockville, effortless thanks to autonomous vehicles, but there'll be more employment right here in Carroll County in the industries I've mentioned. In the evening, you might want to take an autonomous bus to Baltimore for a concert. The Brazilian-American governor is issuing bonds to pay for the renovation of the Baltimore Inner Harbor. The first Asian-American president attends a World Series game in Baltimore, and she roots for the home team. Many people training and seeking their next gig. Another autonomous bus is leaving for Broadway, where Taylor Swift is opening in the title role of Hello, Dolly. $2,400 a ticket, but $1,800 if you buy the tickets when they go on sale in 2040. But most important, residents of Carroll County are grateful for the path paved for them by the people of 2017. Thank you for your attention and for voting. We can have some time for questions now, or you can shoot the futurist, whichever you want to do. There is a microphone here. Anybody want to ask a question from your seat? That's okay too. Yeah.
I'll go to the mic just so you can hear me.
Okay.
Could you define two things in the context of your presentation? Number one, the universal basic income as you see it, although I did look it up on the internet. And number two, can you put a concrete definition on the term affordable housing?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll start with the first. Universal basic income, they have it in certain Scandinavian countries already. It's starting. The idea is that people will get a payment. Now, that's not so usual in America. The residents of Alaska get payments from the oil leases on the state property today. But they will get payments because we've gotten into the gig economy. This is not welfare. As I said, even Bill Gates will get it. And maybe there'll be several levels of it. And I think it'll be financed by taxing automation. But how it will come, I don't know. But you know, they mail Social Security checks, or they electronically mail Social Security checks today. And I guess that will be done. Affordable housing is in the eye of the beholder, I guess. I mean, I can define it today. I think that's the context of your question. That affordable housing is what if we want to attract more people to live in a community, and we don't want the community to only be people who are very wealthy, and we want all strata to be represented, and that is healthy to do, then we have to have housing that people can afford. I don't think it means necessarily a government program for affordable housing. That has been done, but in Montgomery County, I know that's a county all of you love, but in Montgomery County, when they build a new development, they have to have a certain number of houses in what the county council has determined is in that range. It can't all be very expensive. And I guess that's been fairly successful, but not as much as they want. But I think that will be a challenge for you to county. What Carroll County does will be different than Montgomery County, different from Los Angeles. Yeah. All right.
Over there?
Yeah, go over there.
Well, you seem to be on a bit of a roll with the whole idea. Oh. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, a little.
Seem to be on a bit of a roll with the idea of basically autonomous cars, basically everything controlled by AI. Have you considered the possibility that if that were to be the case, 30 years down the road, that's basically kind of putting everything in everyday life at risk of what every bit of technology would be at risk of? Hackers, cyber attacks, the works, really.
Yeah, you are correct. This is a danger, and maybe I should have mentioned that, but I would say this. Already, what if the power grid goes down? Well, I do know now that because the cellular infrastructure does not go down when the power grid goes down, so the cars will still be able, emergency vehicles will still be able to get around. Now, AI depends, you are right, where does it come from? If a robot is coming from a Chinese factory, or the software for the AI is coming from a Chinese factory, could the robot be manufactured so in some way it is more advantageous to China, or China can change it if they need to, or if on Wall Street the artificial intelligence can be saying invest in China and that kind of thing. How that will be inspected, that will have to be inspected, so that isn't the case. But it is a problem for sure. And I think in 30 years I'll have a way around it, but still there will be criminal use of AI and drones and robotics, for
sure.
And
that's not just considering the attacks that can be made on itself. I mean, consider this. As we change, so does everything else around us, meaning everything gets a lot more high-tech, a lot more advanced. who's to say that AI will be, well, too smart for its own good?
I agree, and that is the problem with the singularity. These are really problems that you are raising. I agree. I have the faith that by 2047, we will have a handle on these things, but it won't be easy because going through this era, that is a problem. And the kinds of things you are mentioning will delay the deployment of these things because people in government and the law enforcement are worried about some of these things. But I am optimistic.
A lot of them will be a bit...
What?
That a lot of them, like when they do hear that AI, that there will be a step taken towards a lot of different things being monitored, controlled by AI, a lot of them would be a bit, that's what I'm looking for, cynical, I believe it is. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I believe that it's going to take time. And maybe some of the things will take place in 2048. I don't know, but I do think, you know, these are things to think about. They're not predictions, they're things to think. I'm not backing away. I think these will be handled by 2047. But these are things to think about and be concerned about over the next 30 years, as a lot of people are.
All right. That's all.
Okay.
This isn't a question, it's a comment.
Yeah.
I read, I don't remember where I read it, they had two computers, the AI, talking to each other. And what happened was they created their own language that the programmers could not deal with. They had to turn them off. So AI, well, you know, the opportunity's there. You also got to watch out because they're smarter than we are and they don't have any emotions.
Yeah, that is absolutely correct. But another AI application is we won't need translators anymore. If I go and I meet a person from France and they're talking in French, they'll automatically be of some earphone that I have. Not just a translation, an immediate translation to English, but in the tone of voice of that person. But how do we know that we're really getting the translation? How do we know that somebody hasn't intervened or purposely or for whatever reason? So whatever they're saying to me, really, I think they're saying something else. These are problems. But what, you know, when they said, oh, there's going to be nurse practitioners, oh, we can't have that. This will be terrible. People will be dying and misdiagnosed. When they said no more, that the banking is going to be online, I remember the ATM, when they first said that. I said, why would anyone take out money right out there on the street? Someone sees them doing it, and they know they've just gotten cash. That hasn't been the problem that we thought it would be. So I think a lot of these things, they surprise us how they work out. But you're right about being concerned. Any concerns about anything about humans? Yeah.
Do you have any thoughts on the place of the United States versus emerging countries 30 years from now?
Yeah, well, that is a big question. I tried to stay away, but that is certainly will impact Carroll County and every county. My feeling is, we're just going to be another player. As I also said, we're not going to be the central focus of the world anymore. I think one of the big questions is what would be America's role in human rights in these other countries of the world? It's diminishing now, and will that be able to continue in some form, even as another player? But we will be doing a lot of manufacturing here at home, as will other countries, and possibly trading. Again, we won't be depending on trading partners the way we are today. The natural resources won't be as important because we can manufacture natural resources. Okay, wait. Wait, the two commissioners, I take this one first.
I know some of this is a mental stretch, but do you really think the Orioles could be in the World Series?
They have been in the past. Okay. They were playing the Mets. And the Back to the Future picked the Cubs. And the Cubs got into postseason play, at least. Yeah.
I'll go to the mic.
He likes the microphone.
So I found this. Hello, we have a mic here?
Yeah.
Yeah, are we on? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So I found this to be very thought-provoking, Jay. And one of the most interesting things that you said, I thought, was when one of the slides you talked about the fact that state-of-the-art IT, robotics, artificial intelligence people are being moved from a company's remote location to the corporate office because they want to be maybe in the center of the city where there's office. But I want to invert that question. Carroll County is known across the state for having a very high quality of life. Lowest crime in the state, highest graduation rates in the state, second lowest unemployment in the state, high graduation rates, beautiful neighborhoods. What is the possibility, going back to this theory, that people basically want to can be more disconnected from where they work, that the very strengths that we have today could become the reason why more workers will co-locate here to have the higher quality of lifestyle that is embodied in the natural evolution of how Carroll became what Carroll is.
Correct. That I agree with you, but first, isn't it good that these people, these faceless people, will want to come here to work, and they will bring with them certain things that are good characteristics. But I think what I have found and seen over the years is that any area that is attractive to people, they have good schools and the housing and all of this, education and jobs, they become overcrowded at one time because everybody gets the idea that they want to live there. And then there is a retrenching, and that's one of the issues, I think, in the housing crisis we had more recently nationwide. I think you have to decide on the trade-offs, but first of all, I am aware that Carroll County has all of those characteristics. And it's not only the people in this room that know that. So people are going to want to come here. Whether there's a downside to that, I don't know, because, again, there's always going to be a question, lots of people moved to Houston during the time I lived there. I don't think Houston got any worse for it. Of course, the traffic and things like that. But it's different in each place. Isn't this the issue of immigration, too, that we deal with in a national level, that some people are pro-immigration, some are against it? There's no one answer, but it's dealing with something that is happening, and again, the immigrants say, well, I don't want to live in El Salvador. I want to live in America. So they come here. It's something similar. I hope it's not a problem for you. I didn't think of it as a problem, but I live in Montgomery County, so I can't change my worldview. What? Any other questions? Yeah. She chose number four.
I just wanted to ask a question about futurism in general, because your conversation today was definitely very interesting and thought-provoking. But what I'm curious about is, what is the data that was used to come up with your presentation, and is it generally believed in the world of futurism that this is how it's going to play out, or is this your expert opinion, and there's lots of other expert opinions out there that are very different?
Yeah, that's a very good question. First, I got the information from all of the reading I do on these topics. And people write books on this is going to happen. That's that person's idea. But I don't believe all of them. And also, then, the people that they say that this will happen, but then they sometimes also give the disadvantages and reasons that it might not. There are many surveys done among the post-millennials, and that's where I got that information from. So it's mostly from reading, but this is not a prediction. None of this might happen. It's indicating a direction that we are going. I don't think that anyone can argue that we have an aging population, we're becoming more urbanized, And we are going more into automation. Those we know. The effects of it and the extent of it are open to question, as are a lot of the other areas I mentioned. What I hope that I've presented, let me just say one more thing, is a template that perhaps the Carroll County government and the LTAC can use this kind of reading, thinking, especially the wild cards, as I said, different scenarios, better scenarios than I have with things that maybe that hit closer to home, that kind of thing. If they can use this kind of thinking and do it within each cluster, not necessarily as a group, within each cluster, see how much agreement there is in these things. I think that would be healthy discussion. Yeah, exactly. Bruce, do you think so? You agree with that? I know. Do you agree with that? Okay, go ahead.
Where do you see the future of the engine going, as far as like solar,
water? Yeah, the renewables? I didn't mention them. There's a tremendous future, and that's an area for sure for the county, the community college. Definitely. I mean, I go around, and you have to, and there's solar panels everywhere and the wind turbines. And what is really good about it is we are discovering ways, even in 2017, where we can store the energy that we don't need right now. That was a problem with renewables. Okay, it's sunny. I took so much energy out. But it's not sunny tomorrow. I have to take off the grid now. Now, two things. I can store the energy with better and better storage technology, and I can sell or trade my energy with someone else or with a company like that. So it is a very important part. We are getting away from fossil fuels. I'm glad I'm not giving this talk back in my former adopted hometown of Houston, but we are getting away from fossil fuels. Coal also is being replaced by economics, not by anybody's law, but by market considerations. So those are going to be important, and there's going to be better storage and better ways of trading energy among individuals and companies by 2047, I think. Yeah. You have a question?
No questions.
You're just chairing the meeting.
Any last questions before we express our
appreciation?
No more. Any more questions? Anything we didn't cover today that you wish we had covered?
Yeah, that's right. We've had a few of those so far. You, Bruce, you have anything?
Well,
Chris, you have anything?
Okay, well, in that case, everybody, let's show our appreciation to Jay for the fine job he's done. Thank you, Jay. Okay.
A good audience, very good audience.
Thank you for coming, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. I enjoyed it. Yeah. Thank you all. Very good audience.